This morning, I want to read a portion of scripture. It's from 2 Kings, the 11th chapter, and it's a couple of verses. And this is kind of a, not the back to school service, but this is a message to families that are getting ready to send kids back to school. We're going to pray and anoint and get those wristbands that we do every year here in a couple weeks. But I want to talk to families that are getting ready with a little bit of hesitation, with a little bit of reservation about sending their kids back into an environment that has changed in such a dramatic way, from especially those who raised their hands that went to school back when, well, you were still going to pull the little tassels off of corn in August, and you were not thinking about school until after Labor Day. Your school and your environment that you were a part of is long gone in our school systems. And I know there's hesitations and reservations, and there's probably some in here that are thinking, and we got little kids here that that parents are, you've got 2 or 3 years, you're like, well, what am I going to do? Am I going to somehow try to get enough financing and get our finances in place so that we can go to private Christian schools? Am I going to do co-ops with homeschooling and the new venture that way? Am I going to go online schools? And we're thinking about avoiding the public school system with the wokeness and all the difficulty. And I want to talk to you. I want to help you just a little bit in this message. And grandparents, you need to jump in and understand and be praying, because these are difficult, these are challenging times like we didn't face. Even myself, Mary and I, just, you know, our kids have been out of school 5 and 7 years. We didn't face any of these issues. And even then, we were like a little bit challenged. But I always step back to that very first place that I see education and school working together, and that was in the book of Exodus, when Moses, who was a child of God, who was going to be a leader of God, was sent where? Not to a private school, not to a home school, but to public education, and into one of the most immoral, corrupt, different culture, idea, mindset of what education was about. They sent him into an Egyptian school, didn't they? And not only did he survive, but he thrived. And he was prepared to face the battle and the challenges and the enemies that would come, because he understood the educational system. But what helped him survive, and what allowed him to have success, was not the school system, but it was the family unit. It was the home that he lived in. That no matter what was taught in the school, and no matter what he was surrounded by and the peers around him, when he walked into his home, there was a different environment. There was a different mindset. There was a different education. There was every time he walked in, he had heard about the Egyptian gods. He had heard about the pharaohs and all the 10 plagues that are going. He knew all about those things. But when he walked in the door, over the house of his door, there was the hero Israel, the Lord God. He is one. And when he walked in and talked to his mama began to say, "Hey, Moses, I want you to know about the God that's been working in my home today. I want to talk to you about the songs I've been." There was an atmosphere created that no matter what was in that world, in his home, there was God. And that is the culture, that is the environment that we've got to come to a realization. This cannot be a Sunday morning activity that is a part of your life, that you come and you clock in and you do your thing and you get a little inspiration and you just step back into the world and you don't cover, that you don't protect, that you don't do things to make sure that the environment on a daily basis is the same environment that you have here. You don't get Cole and Mace, you don't get me preaching, but you can create an atmosphere, you can create a culture in your home as grandparents, as parents, that says, "The Lord, He is God." No matter what's happening in your school, no matter what is being said about gender, no matter what's being said about social issues, in this home, you will be taught that there is a God, and there is a way, and there is a truth. That is what we've got to do in this hour. I'm not intimidated. I invite the challenge because Acts, it says of David, talking about David, David was made for this generation. I believe some of you, your children were made for this generation. When he looked at 2022, he did not look at 2022 and say, well, I better have Simon Peter there. I better have Paul there. Maybe I need an Elijah there. No, he made the decision for 2022. He needed your child in this generation. He believed that you could stand for the truth. He believed that your child could make a difference. He believed that your children could do greater things and that you could handle this, they could handle this generation through you better than anyone else. God has confidence in this generation. So I want to read a moment of time that is similar to what we're facing today, 2 Kings chapter 11, verses 2 and 3. Behold, Jehosheba, the daughter of King Joram, sister of Ahaziah, took Joash, the son of Ahaziah, and stole him from among the king's sons who were being put to death. And he placed him and his nurse in the bedroom. So they hid from Athaliah, and he was not put to death. Verse 3. So he was hidden with her in the house of the Lord for 6 years while Athaliah was made reigning over the land. I want to speak on this thought for the next few moments. Hidden in the house. You've got to hide your kids in the house. You've got to put them in a place. Now, I wonder, of all the games that have transitioned through the years, and you know, we've changed from kids just being outside and playing to now it's Xbox and PlayStation, but I wonder how many little kids still play hide-and-go-seek. I got all my kids in here. How many of the little kids, you play hide-and-seek every once in a while? It's still a game, all right. Plus, you probably play that from mom and dad, especially when you know you're in trouble. I see the Elkins. So good to have the Elkins with us. And I'm reminded of a moment when their son, Corey and Alicia, were our music leaders, that little Larkin was playing hide-and-seek with me. And she was just a little child, and we were out in the lobby. And she said, John, will you play hide-and-seek with me? I said, yeah, I'll be glad to play hide-and-seek with you. She said, okay, you close your eyes and count to 10, and I'll hide. So she is so small, and I count to 10, and I open, and I look, and Larkin is standing behind the kiosk post where we give. And she thinks she has just found the blessed hiding space. And, you know, it is completely obvious to me. So I'm just going, Larkin, where are you? I can't find you anywhere. And I'm looking everywhere. And she is just giggling and snorting and laughing, thinking that she has hidden so well. And we're not good necessarily of hiding sometimes ourselves from the difficulties because we're a little bit like Larkin. We don't hide ourselves in the right place. We try to hide ourselves in our careers, and we try to hide ourselves in entertainment, and we try to hide ourselves in success. And none of those things are going to hide you from the difficulties of life. But can I tell you, there is a hiding place. There is a hiding place in Jesus Christ that no adversary, come on now, will be able to touch you, see you, harm you, no matter what the world says. There is a place, and then I tell you something else, the blood of Jesus Christ will hide your sins, no matter how dark and how bad and how evil. When you get them under the blood of Jesus, they are hidden forever. So we play hide and seek. Our kids like to play hide and seek. You know, one of the real blessings of gentry, buying his own home, is we no longer have to play hide and seek in our home. Because gentry regularly made us play hide and seek with his keys. Every morning, almost, it was just like, let's wake up and have chaos. And, you know, finally we decided, let's get two sets. Well, then he decided to play hide and seek with both sets. So we ended up with three sets of keys. And can you imagine that there were some mornings that he had somehow planted all three sets of keys, and for 15 or 20 minutes, everything in life stalled? It was not a fun moment. So as much as we weep and we miss our son, there is a certain amount of happiness and joy of getting up in the morning and never having to play hide and seek with keys. But there are important things that we should hide. And that's what I want to talk to you about, is what in this moment happened with a mother that saw chaos, that saw darkness, that saw evil, that saw violence coming. The previous king had been removed from power. He had died, and the new queen that was going to step in was coming in and bringing in Baal worship and was bringing in violence and doing evil all over the place. And this mom realizes, I cannot change culture. I cannot change society. I cannot change the direction of my government. I cannot change the direction of education. Are you following me? I don't have the ability in myself, but I do have the ability to do something. And that's what I want you to know today. We may not be able to change all the wokeness, and we may not be able to change all the social issues and all the dynamics of life that are in place. That does not mean that you are weak and vulnerable and broken. That means there is a place that God will prepare for you to help you in this moment when you have to send children away, when you have to do things. But you've got to make some decisions. You've got to make some choices. You've got to have an awareness. She has this awareness. Wow, I'm watching what's happening. These men are being killed. These sons of the king are being, I've got to do something. I've got to do something to protect my child. I got to do something different. I can't just let where society is going, and I can't just let what is happening in this world necessarily happen to me. Can I speak to some families this morning? You just can't let the world continually press in on your life. You do have some choices. You do have some options. And the option that you should choose is the same option that she chose. That when the things got difficult and when the world got ugly, when there's chaos all around, she said, I've got to find a place to hide my child. I got to find a place in evil times and when darkness is covering the land and when God is being mocked and when religion is being ridiculed and immorality is being applauded. Does that remind you of any time? I'm not talking about today. That's what was being said 2,000, 3,000 years ago. The same issue. It doesn't go away. But there, and guess what? We're still here with the gospel. We're still here with a great God that can do it exceedingly and abundantly. And they survived. So all the doomsday people that want to say, hey, there's no hope for this world, I'm here to tell you, if you'll put your trust in Jesus Christ, if you'll hide your life, if you'll hide your family, if you'll hide your children in Jesus Christ, it's going to be okay. We're going to make it through it, and we're not just going to hang on. We're going to thrive. We're going to survive. But it takes action. It takes activity. And this mama got a passion. This mama got a burden. She said, I got to do something. What can I do? And she said, I got one thing that I know. I know the house of God is a protected place. I know if I get outside the house of God that there might be violence and there might be difficulty. But if I can get in the house of God, if I can get in the presence of God, I know there that God is going to protect, that God is going to shield, that God is going to cover. Come on, somebody. You need to be in the house of God in dark hours because you need that covering. You need that shield. You need that protection. And God's going to protect his house. And so she looks. She's like, where can I go? Can I go to the school systems? Can I go to? No, but I can go to the house of God. And when everybody else is falling away, she takes her child and sticks him in the house of God. And there he stays for 6 years. For ears, nothing that he hears, nothing that he sees, nothing that he tastes, nothing that he feels is anything but inside the house and the presence of God. Ooh, what an environment to grow up in, not to grow up in the culture, not to grow up in the world, not to grow up in the vileness, but to grow up in the house, in the presence of the Almighty God, to be in the atmosphere of the glory of the Lord and the presence of God. And that's my challenge to you this morning, is to make a decision. Okay, we don't have a physical temple that you can bring your children here. You can't just, I'm sorry, we can't bring make this a commune. We don't want that. That's not the idea. Bring them all here and we'll just hunker down. No. But there's a principle there, isn't there? That within my house, within my four walls. But Pastor, it's so bad out there, and there's so much immorality, and there's so much darkness, and that doesn't define your home. Darkness can go everywhere, but there's a doorstep. There's a front door in your house. There's a sliding glass door on the back. There's a garage door. There's walls around. And while all that can press in, and maybe violence has visited your home once in a while, we've been broken into 4 times in our life. I don't know where we got that blessing from the Lord, but we know what it is to be broken into. But thankfully, you know, by the grace of God, the last 15 or 20 years, we haven't had that. We had one break in here in Fishers, and 3 when we were in Indianapolis. And it's a scary environment. But there's a certain amount of safety in there once you're inside your home. But your home has to be something different than this world. And the story I spoke of, Moses, is an incredible example of that. That he goes, and in this particular moment, he goes into the education. It allows him to write the books of the first 5 books of the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. He writes them because he's got the education, but not the influence. It's critical to understand the difference. Receive the proper education. I'm very much pro-education. Learn how to read. Learn how to write. Learn how to have science. Have that in your life. But don't accept the social agenda that's being pushed and shoved down your throat. And while it's there, when they walk into your home, the moment they walk into that house, there needs to be a different environment there. That the world has pushed in all the way around your house. But as soon as they walk in the door, there should be a different environment. There should be a different culture. There should be a different atmosphere there. You should be hiding them in your house. Come on now, you need to hide them in your house. That when they walk in the house, there should be a stark difference. It shouldn't be mediocrity. It shouldn't look like the world. It should be starkly different inside your home than it is outside in this world. You have got to create a home that hides the presence of God. So when they walk in there, they feel the refreshing. They feel the anointing. They feel the glory of the Lord, just like Joash did. So when Joash was, what did he grow up in? He grew up around hearing the sounds of praise. Hearing the sounds of worship, hearing the sounds of a priest praying and crying out to God. He heard, he could smell the incense of the giving of sacrifice, that sweet-smelling savor. He witnessed the sacrifices on the altar. Come on, what is your children seeing in your home? Are you hiding them in your home? Are they being exposed to the very same thing in their home that they see in their world? What do they see from you? What do they experience in your home? To hide them in the home means to hide them in Christ, to hide them in God in that environment. And when they walk in, what do they hear? What do they see? I'm not, I'm going to push in just on some things a little bit. Moderation and activity are fine. But if they're constantly seeing just, you're just filling them with violent video games. They see you doing it, and you're buying those things for them. What kind of culture are you creating inside your home? I don't think it's coincidence that there's more violence and more evil, because that's what's coming inside every home. It's brought in from a very early age, and you've got to make a decision. Well, I can do it. You're going to bring in a spirit. Whatever you bring in, you're bringing in spirits. And you've got to make a decision, even in your own life. For the sake of my family, for the hiding of my family in this house, this doesn't come in through this door. It can come up to this door, but it doesn't come in. What are you watching on video? What are you putting in front of yourself? What culture, what environment are you bringing in? You better be protected, because you got children, and if you're going to hide them in the house, you got to hide them where the presence of, there's got to be a different environment than they're experiencing every single day. I don't care what your choice of music. Listen to your country. Listen to your easy. Listen to your rap. Listen to whatever you want to. There's a moment in time for all of it. There's a moment I just can't do any more Hillsong. There's a time where please, Maverick City, please go away. Pull out a gun and shoot yourself. Please, if you're wokeness, I'm using a cartoon example, please. Sometimes I just need a good old country song or something. Even old Spiritual Mary, every once in a while I walk in and she's got Kenny G going. So I'm going, get the cologne. Because you want to create an environment. Hello, you want that environment. But we got to make sure that when they walk into the home, that the environment, even then, that they've had a tough day and they've been exposed to this, they've been exposed. And if they walk into a home and the refreshing presence of the Almighty God is there, it will begin to wear on them. It will begin to impact them. It will begin to challenge them. Average parents at best. We could have done a lot of things better. I'm really convinced of that with both of my kids. And sometimes I still look at the birth certificate to make sure Gentry's mine. I have no idea where he is right now. And every weekend you just pray, God, please, don't let the police come to the door and tell us that he's dead. He's his own kid. But there's one thing that if you talk to our kids, they will tell you. There was a consistency, and it was luck more than knowledge. It was God's grace more than us being super spiritual people. But we learned the principle of Jehoshaphat, who hid their kids, who hid her child in the house, who hid her child in the presence of God. Rissa will shake her head, and if Gentry was here, he would do the same, that every single morning that they woke up, there was music, gospel, Christian, some kind of music going on. Michael W., yep. Who else, Riss?
Israel.
Clint Brown. She can give you the list. They have the playlist. They made it just recently. That's a statement of how the culture was that creates the environment that shields your children. They heard and they saw morning after morning their parents getting up and praying. And I will never forget, because at the time I would come over here every morning. We were all getting up at 6 in the morning, and I would be here, and I would come into this place and pray for an hour, 2 hours. It was just my ritual. And I'll never forget the morning. First, it was Gentry when he's got his car. Hey, Dad, I'm going to the church. I'm going to go pray. And then it was my daughter almost every day before school. While people were ridiculing her because we had made some transitions and the outward appearance and stuff, I knew there was depth there. There was power there. She was here at the church. And not only her, I would remember Chase and Morgan and Brendan. They would just come to the house. How does that happen? Is that just accident? No, that's intentional. That is family after family saying, the house of the Lord is a priority. We're going to hide our children in God's presence. And there is something that happens when you hide your kids in the presence of God. It gives them a chance to succeed when all the world is pressing around you. And you can have a confidence. I want you to leave today and go out and have fun to go. It's going to be okay, 22, 23. Our kids are going to make it through it. And you're going to be able to say that if you hide them in the house, if you hide them in the presence of the Almighty God. And after 6 years of hiding them, he said, it's time to bring them out. It's time to bring Josiah out. And I come to a close this morning. Hiding your family is critical. And after 6 years of just dwelling in the presence, just having them in that environment, in that moment, what I'm calling you to is going to be a challenge. I'm not saying this is going to be easy, but you're going to have to make some decisions. You're going to have to be intentional. You know what? We're going to show them faithfulness. We're going to be here on Sunday. And I know some of you have drives and some of you have jobs, but if you're sitting home eating potato chips and watching reruns of whatever on a Wednesday night, you need to get to the house of God. I may not say anything worth it, but you're demonstrating to your children, we hide our families. We hide them in the house of God. Our kids got so tired of Saturday night, but they lived here on Saturday nights. I'm proud of Jake and Rissa. They already got Carter coming on a Saturday night. They're like, well, he's crying. That's okay. There's nothing like them hearing. I understood this early. I want my children to hear the cry of saints. I want them to hear the prayers of people. There will never be a class upstairs. There will never be a class in this room as far as I know. Hey, we're going to teach you how to pray. How do you learn to pray? You get into the environment where other people are praying. And 15, 20, especially those that are over 50 are in here every Saturday night praying in this room. And if you can't make it four times, make it one time a month. But start making it a priority where your kids just hear the sounds of prayer, where it's not foreign to them. There are too many spiritual things that are foreign to this generation. And if we're not careful, they'll lose the appreciation and understanding of the value. That's what happened to Joash as he grew up around it, and it began to integrate and become part of the DNA and the culture of his life. Your children will not be people of prayer. Your children will not be consistently to the house of God. If they cannot mimic something that you do not do. And they will not value a culture that you do not create. We fail in some areas. We have weaknesses in some of our ministries here at this church. But it does not lay it at all of our feet. You have to take responsibility. You're the priest of your home. You've got to create the culture. And you're giving opportunities. And at the end of the day, you have to know and look at your own life and say, did I do my best? Was I intentional above all else? Was the soccer ball, was the basketball, was the baseball, more relevant, more important. And none of those things are wrong, they're right. But you've got to teach the importance of God's house. You've got to hide them, this place first. What Jesus say? Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these other things will be added unto you. If you get God right in their lives first, they'll blossom, they'll grow, they'll turn out incredible. 2 Kings, the 12th verse of chapter 11. After being hidden in the house, after being hidden, wouldn't it be nice to know what happened after being hidden in the house? After simmering and saturating in the presence of God. Man, you got to do it. You got to make a decision. I'm going to do this in my life. I'm going to do this with my children. You're going to have to step up. You're going to have to step up to a different level, different way of thinking. Your parents may not have done this, and you may have said, but I'm here to challenge you. Do something different so that we get to something. It's not the same world. And so we've got to do things differently. 2 Kings chapter 11, verse 12. Then he brought the king's son out. There's a moment you'll be able to bring him out. And put a crown on him and gave him the testimony. And they made him king and anointed him. And they clapped their hands and said, long live the king. What I want you to see, there was a moment they realized he can stand in this world. If you put them in the presence of God, there's a moment you go, they're not just going to survive. They are going to thrive. They are going to be powerful. They are going to be worshipers. They're going to be warriors. They're going to make a difference in the world. Can I tell you, you've got kids. You've got little children that can be world changers in this room. Do you believe it? Put a crown on him. What was it saying? Hey, you have value. And your kids need to know they have value in a world that says nothing has value. Marriage doesn't have value. Life doesn't have value. Nothing has value. You can put a crown on your kids when you keep them in the presence of God that says you have value. You have worth. You have purpose. You have a life. You are going to make a difference. When you put a crown on them, you say you have worth and value. What's the second thing they did? They gave them a testimony. They gave him the word of God and said, this is what you've been experiencing. This, now take the word, take the experience and carry it. Go into all the world and teach the gospel. Do what you can to make a difference. It's been 6 years. Hasn't been long. He was 1 or 2, maybe 3 years old when he goes in. He's just 8 or 9. He's not very old when he comes out. But he went in weak. He went in as a baby. He comes out just as a, come on, he's a young man. And he comes out strong. And a confidence that God is great and greatly to be praised. That God is mighty. He is bigger than the darkness. The darkness that is still there. The vileness that is still. This Joash has a different attitude because he'd been growing up in hidden in a house. Third thing that they gave him, they said, you are anointed. You have oil on you. Can I tell you, every child that gets in the presence of God, there's an anointing. There is something different on that child. And when they step out, there is blessing. There is favor. You got to teach your kids that there is blessing and favor on their lives when they walk with God. It's not a have to. It's a get to. It's an I want to. This is the greatest place. This is the greatest opportunity. I have anointed. I'm going to walk out differently. Hidden in the house and spoken the right words over, you come to this closing as we stand this morning. Chapter 12, the second verse. in the darkened world when everybody was saying hopeless. And they didn't hide their child. Jehosheba hides her son. Those 6 years, that time frame is not relevant. It's the hiding. It's the protecting. It's the surrounding. It's the culture. It's environment. She hides him. And she speaks the word. She puts value in his life. She anoints him. She does all those things. And when he steps out in chapter 12, his now name is now Jehoash, did right in the sight of the Lord. What? How long? All the days of his life. They raised up a leader. They raised up a king. He tore down the Baals. He tore out the worldliness. He changed the culture. He changed the environment. What she couldn't do, she raised in the house of a hidden, in a hidden house. She raised up a child that could. And he changed the entire culture of a country. Can I tell you, if a group of people will get a hold of the presence of God and store it in your home and raise your children up in the fear and the admonition, you can change the culture. We're one generation away from a mighty move of God. But you gotta hide them in the house. Changed everything. If we show them the value of the house, they will lead by the value of the house. But if you show them the value of the world, then they will lead in the value of the world. Heads bowed this morning. Lord, incredible families. There's so many young families in this church with one-year-olds, two-year-olds, five-year-olds. And I don't envy them at all. God, I cover them in prayer. And I ask, God, that you would give them wisdom. There's not a grandparent that understands the fear and the uncertainty that these young parents are feeling. There's not a person that even may have a kid in high school that understands the dynamics, how they have shifted. And in this hour of great challenge, God, you have come with a word this morning that there's hope, not hopelessness. There's not impossibility, there's possibility. But we've got to turn with all of our heart. And decide that our homes, that our lives will be focused and centered, that they will be God-centered. And I'm praying, God, that this message will be received and that this risk, not just be received, we need implementation. We need it to be implemented. There's got to be spiritual decisions. And here in a moment, God, I'm going to opportunity to ask them to step out and say, I want to have a home. And I pray that they'll have courage, God, to step out this morning and say, we're going to do what we can to create a home in Jesus' name. Now I'm going to ask you to do that. If you're a family here, I want you to come and just stand here at the front. This altar is not a place of just brokenness. It's a place of commitment. It is a place of saying, we're going to implement it. I love it. I love it. Just come here. You're not doing it for me. You're doing it to God. You're making a statement that we're going to do it differently. I love these families. Come on. Let's give it up for these families that are stepping up. I love it.